road winds and twists through deep valleys, very wild and beautiful. The tropical vegetation is luxuriant. We stop to look at two wild-looking men as they stand quaking with fear at the sight of us. These are the Katu, the blood hunters, we call them, for they not only sacrifice animals, but human beings. I try to ask them questions, but they understand none of the dialects I know. They cling closer to each other, their right hands resting nervously on the hilts of their long knives. It is only agitating them to talk longer, so with a smile, I pat them on the back and go on. My grandfather wrote those words and took these pictures, and for years entertained me with stories of meeting exotic cultures. The missionary zeal to convert has long been controversial, but through the images he left behind, I've tried to imagine why missionaries set out to change the world.
Long before the first Americans in combat fatigues came to Vietnam with their battalions, this one in a tropical suit came with his family. Many Americans gave their lives to this place waging war. He gave his life too, nearly 50 years of it, pursuing peace. Gordon Smith had a different dream for Indochina. What if his dream had been the one that came true? In the year 1929, a wood-burning steamer churned up the Mekong River toward a small town called Kratier. On board were Gordon and Laura Smith, full of apprehension, but determined and excited. They were going to establish a small Protestant church in a place that never had had one. They were on their first assignment as missionaries. They knew it was going to be a hard life. It turned out to be harder than they imagined.
Cambodia is a hot, damp country and not fit for white folks to live in. So many different diseases have visited us that it's hard to recall them in order. Without a let-up, one or another of the four of us have had dysentery, malaria, sore eyes, fainting spells, hemorrhages, measles, bronchitis, enteric diarrhea, and bronchopneumonia. But it's baby Leslie who suffered most.
It has to be a commitment. And I can't say that it's the easiest thing. It never got easier.
Marie Zimmer, a missionary herself.
They talk about pioneer missionaries. I would say the Smiths were the pioneer missionaries.
They became U.S. citizens in time, but they started life in Canada. Gordon Smith came from a sheltered upbringing in Toronto, and Laura from a family farm in Dalrymple, Ontario. Both were attracted by the romance of faraway places. The farther away, the better. When they found that they shared a dream of missionary life, they rushed to marry. Their assignment was just the sort they hoped for, to learn the French language and a stopover in Paris, and then go on to preach in mysterious Indochina. But to whom would they preach? It is likely that they had never heard of the rugged and independent hill people known as Montagnards.
I remember this group of mountain people that came down to trade with the Cambodians in the town of Kratier. And one of these people was a...
Douglas Smith, that, eldest of the Smiths' three sons, was a child in Kratier.
His hair was tied up in a bun, great ivory ear plugs in his ears, and he was smoking this large pipe and carrying a wicker basket as well as a large spear.
These were people very much different from the lowland Cambodians and Vietnamese.
Physically, they look very different from the Vietnamese. This is a very important thing.
Anthropologist Gerald Hickey, a friend of the Smiths, who has studied the Montagnards.
Of course, they have a culture that the Vietnamese have never basically understood. The fact that they build their houses on piling and stilts, sort of. The fact that they wear very little clothes because they're in a very hot climate. Very often, in the old days, the women never wore anything above the waist. And the Vietnamese always considered this very primitive.
The Montagnards made Gordon Smith's heart beat faster. Here was a people unto itself, utterly untouched through all its history by any notion of Christianity. The Montagnards presented a pure challenge. Gordon Smith set himself to making friends among the tribesmen, then to devising the first grammars and dictionaries of their unwritten language, then to visiting their homes in the highlands. And there he ran into trouble with the French colonial overseers of Indochina. The inflexible policy of the French was to keep the Montagnards isolated from foreigners, especially from foreign missionaries.
There was one French administrator that was dead set against him doing mission work. And I remember the day that he was summoned in by this French administrator. He was called the Resident. And I stayed in the car, but I heard sharp words coming from the office. And when my father left, he was pale. His face was as pale as a white sheet. And I later found out that the French administrator had slapped him in the face and accused him of disobeying his orders, and he was going to have to leave the Highlands.
Gordon Smith did not leave. The bureaucrat who slapped him did. Gordon Smith pressed on into the mountains.
God opened the door for us in 1934 to follow a trail 200 miles into the heart of this southern tribal area, and we settled in a little strategic town called Ban Mae Thuot.
Ban Mae Thuot was remote from the rest of the world, but to the Montagnards, a center of their culture. The Smiths settled their growing family in a Montagnard-style house and built a longhouse church, which soon attracted hill people, intrigued by these strangers from so far away. At a Christmas dinner, Gordon and Laura and their sons seemed a settled family, but comfort for themselves always gave way to the importance the Smiths attached to their mission.
One of the other things that I think a lot of missionaries might not take into consideration before they leave.
Betty Mitchell met the Smith sons at the school to which the boys were sent in Dalat, many miles away.
That the children would go to school and might not be on the same station where we would be. And so that the children would probably be separated from us for their schooling.
My darling boys, we've received your letters and we were hungry to read them. I miss you boys more now than I ever did. How are you getting along with your music now, Douglas? Leslie, sweet boy, don't you fight. Don't get your new good suit dirty on Sundays. Many hugs and kisses to my little man, Stanley. I hope you big boys are loving and kind to your little brother. Is he happy up there? Heaps of hugs and kisses, your own mommy.
Lonely as their lives were sometimes, Gordon and Laura Smith might have lived in perfect peace with the Montagnards, if only the Montagnards had been able to live in peace themselves. But one band of Montagnards or another was constantly in revolt against the French colonialists. The French demanded unpaid laborers to build roads. These villagers refused and killed a soldier. Government troops approached the high bamboo walls of the village along a narrow path lined with poisoned stakes. The tension broke only when the village headman came out to negotiate and seeing that his people were outnumbered, surrendered some of his men to be road builders. Montagnard leader I Yukayun grew up near Ban Maituan.
The French people did try to help us, but sometimes they didn't treat us well. When we worked on their plantations, they said very bad words to all Montagnard people. Sometimes they beat us. Sometimes they would pay us, but other times, especially for the building of their roads, they wouldn't pay. They would kick us and insult us. It was very bad.
Gordon and Laura Smith tried with all their might to show the Montagnards a kinder face of Western civilization. From what must have been the first trailer in Indochina, they dispensed aspirin and safety pins and genuine neighborliness. Inagong Kanul, a chieftain, was a boy when he first saw the Smiths and their trailer.
The first time I saw it, it was strange for me. It was like a big box. I still remember, when he went to preach somewhere, they usually brought their pictures with them, real big pictures.
They were storytelling pictures on sheets of flannel, and the stories they told bespoke a spiritual power that touched and impressed some of the listeners. The way seemed open now a little. In the marketplace to which the Montagnards came down to do their trading, Gordon and Laura Smith began to spread the word. And if the Montagnards didn't come to the Smiths went to them by car as far as a car could go, and then by other forms of transportation. Gordon Smith made a film to be shown at fundraising functions back home. He played the role of a Montagnard elder. Laura Smith played the visiting missionary.
Jackethem Lema?
Huh?
May I come up to visit with you?
Well, it's up to you.
See all these little black marks? They are the words of God talking to us from this book.
What do they say?
Well, they tell us the true story of the chief of the skies. It was God who made all the heavens. It was God who made the sun, the moon, and the stars. God made all the world. And God made all mankind. You know God made you red-brown people here in the jungle, too.
No, he didn't make us red-A people. We came out of a hole in the ground. You can go over and see it. It's called Bung Dreng. We sacrifice buffalo over there every year.
God, the great chief of the skies, sent his only son down to this earth, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die on that cross, a sacrifice once and for all. This is the only sacrifice God will accept.
Tell him to chase the demons out of that old banyan tree out there.
You think there is a demon in that magnificent banyan tree?
There's another one down there in the whirlpool, too.
Listen. He can set you free from the devil's power.
I've got a better way. I'll take this new Yang.
Yang Yesu.
I'll accept his sacrifice. And then he won't be angry at me. And then I'll keep my own animal sacrifices. And then the demons won't be angry at me. And then I'll have them both, and I'll be sure. Of course, you'll pay my taxes, won't you?
I became a Christian when I heard Mr. Smith preach. He taught me to know God. We often saw at that time Mrs. Smith play the piano, and Mr. Smith would teach us how to sing. They even sang in Rade.
For centuries, the Montagnards had believed in the power of blood sacrifice to appease the gods. And so the Smith's message of a god who made a great sacrifice for human beings struck a powerful chord in these mountains. But of course, the Smiths wanted to do much more than merely graft their religion to that of the Montagnards. They wanted to plant the seeds of the true faith and see it develop native roots and grow into a sturdy tree of Montagnard Christianity.
Christians at Buntangju are giving their tithes of the rice harvest to the Lord. Look at it all. See their native preacher in the red sweater. He's going to have enough rice for a whole year. This is establishing the native church. Some newly converted that very day gave us their sacrificial bracelets.
The bracelets were tokens of blood sacrifices the villagers had made. Those who gave up their bracelets gave up the past.
The mountain tribal people were not Buddhists or Confucianists or ancestor worshippers. They're animists, spirit worshippers.
Stanley Smith, Gordon and Laura's youngest son, later became a missionary himself.
They believe that the blood of the animal, whether it's a chicken, a pig, or a water buffalo, must be offered to the spirits to bring good health, good luck, and good crops. The spirits must be appeased, and it is only accomplished by the shedding of blood.
Oh, demons of the north, south, east, and west, demons big and little, demons of the trees, rocks, and whirlpools, come see the blood of this pig and chicken and give us good crops. Make the rains come. Don't let the monkeys, the civet cats, the deer, the wild boar, or the peacocks ravish our young sprouts.
We sacrifice buffalo to appease all kinds of spirits, mountain spirit, tree spirits, earth spirit, to get them to help us. When we were sick or had family problems, we sacrificed a buffalo. We lived in such remote areas, we had no access to medicines. These customs were all that we could rely on for help.
The water buffalo is precious to the farmers of Southeast Asia. Worker, companion, symbol, and source of wealth. The buffalo often comes to be very like a member of the family. To sacrifice a buffalo is a sacrifice indeed.
They come there, they'll say, oh, that is the able part of the whole thing, but for us, it's the culture.
Pierre Cabrillo is a Montagnard who worked for the South Vietnamese Ministry of Ethnic Minorities.
And if during the sacrifice, that's the only time that the children are allowed to use the gong. But if you don't do any sacrifice, you are not allowed to touch all of those things. It's taboo. And then the children never have a chance to learn their own culture and to learn their own tradition.
Our tribe's people saw off their top front teeth. This hideous custom is one of the rites of passage into manhood and into womanhood. We are the first white people, to our knowledge, to ever see this secret operation. And of course, it has never been photographed before. This little 10-year-old girl in a few minutes will undergo this cruel operation. This is heathenism. The horrors of heathenism must be revealed in all honesty. Boys and girls in our tribe's land all go through this horrible ordeal. The gospel alone can do away with this devilish practice. We must do something about it. Burning sticks with hot black lacquer dripping from them are brought to her. She rubs this into her bleeding gums to cauterize them, to help allay some of the pain in her six open, jumping teeth nerves. Her face swells up, and from now on her facial features will be quite changed.
If you don't do that, then a woman won't like you. He's much more handsome when he do that rather than to keep all of his teeth. Of course, it's terrible. We look, it's terrible, but that's what they that time, and it's a la mode.
When I was a young boy, my parents tried to cut my teeth off, but fortunately, I didn't allow them to do it. My brothers did not cut their teeth off, but my sisters did. We weren't forced to abandon our old customs. We changed because we understood things would be better. It was because of our increased knowledge that we changed.
We're not going anywhere to change culture. Now, if by their accepting the truths, Christian truths that are absolutes, there are some changes, then it would be along the lines of the absolutes taught in Scripture. Not necessarily that the Westerner would come in and say, now this is the way it should be done. We have no right to do that.
If I were to go in as a missionary and projecting myself as a missionary, I would find it very difficult to go in and simply say, well, I'm going to tell you to get rid of all of the religious beliefs that you already have because I'm going to bring you a whole new set of beliefs and values that are religious. This could be very disrupting for them. It could be very disorienting. And it could lead to a good deal of chaos in their lives.
Because our culture is more or less mingled with the belief. And so if you don't draw the line, then what, you lose it. And then if the father lose it, then the son will lose the whole thing. And then in 10 years, then the whole culture is lost.
It is true that the schools formed by the missionaries had a dramatic impact on Montagnard culture.
Now, the role of the missionaries here was very important because a number of the people who were the leaders and beginning to express very strong discontent at what they considered discrimination against them and persecution in some cases, said, you know, the missionaries, the Catholics and the Protestant missionaries alike, told us that in the eyes of God, all men are equal. And they said, therefore, we're equal to the Vietnamese. They said, they may be more considered more civilized than we are, but we're as good as they are, and we're equal to them. We want to be treated like people with equality. And this really was a very strong motivation in the movements that began to grow in the Highlands.
In 1941, Vietnamese and Montagnards, missionaries and French colonialists, all found themselves overwhelmed by battalions of Japanese troops. Gordon Smith and his family were expelled from Vietnam.
June of 1941, we joined our parents down in Saigon, and as we boarded the evacuation ship, it was the French liner, the Maréchal Joffre. We left Saigon Harbor and went down the river, and as we went down the river, we passed troop ship after troop ship, just loaded to the gunwales with troops. It was a huge military buildup.
The war years away from the mission fields gave Gordon and Laura Smith time to write about their experiences and to think about them. Influenced by studies in anthropology, Gordon Smith began to change his view of how missionaries should work. He decided his approach had been flawed by lack of understanding. He wrote this:
the missionary among primitives, unless he has studied them scientifically, knows little about his people, except in a theological sense. He approaches his people with his Western conception of things, not theirs, and he is bound to make blunders. He hates their gods and horrible practices. He is impatient with their superstitions.
When I met him in the 50s, he already had this interest in anthropology and going in and learning about the cultures, and he had a strong feeling for culture. He'd always felt, he told me later on, that you simply couldn't concern yourself with just going in and bringing the word of the Bible and the word of God to the people in a place like the Central Highlands, that they were faced with a lot of problems day to day. And so he felt that he had a responsibility to try and help them as much as he could.
It was not until January 1947 that we were able to return to our jungles after the war. With us, we had some necessary tools, a Dodge car and a Stinson plane. We found the land torn by internal strife and political chaos. The great country districts were still in the hands of the Viet Minh. This meant that travel was very difficult and dangerous. We found the plane indispensable in this time of war. The commerce of the country moved in long military convoys, and these were often attacked. Home at last, we were happy to be back among our brown-skinned jungle folk again.
Rebellion against French control was spreading in Vietnam. To try to head it off, the French ceded nominal control of the highlands to the Vietnamese emperor, Bao Dai.
This is an historic occasion, as for the first time, His Majesty Bao Dai, Chief of State for Vietnam, shared with the French High Commissioner the expression of loyalty of these tribes. Henceforth, these mountaineers of Indochina come under the direct supervision of His Majesty Bao Dai.
Elaborate ceremonies were held in allegiance to the emperor. But Ho Chi Minh's communist guerrillas were on the march through the countryside. Vietnam was about to be shattered by all-out war between the Viet Minh and the French. Gordon Smith, wishing only to minister to the Highlanders, managed to preserve his neutrality.
The French military suspected us of being the forerunners of an American takeover, and we had to live down this absurd notion. We were told that they were trying to discredit our mission in Indochina and have us put out. If we showed friendship with the French, the Vietnamese suspected us of upholding the French colonial policy. So we had to walk a precarious line and keep out of politics entirely.
In the early 1950s, some evangelical Protestant missionaries saw that saving souls wasn't enough. Bodies needed saving too. Gordon Smith had seen the victims of leprosy, exiled from their home villages for fear of contagion, had seen them dying in jungle huts. To care for these people, he began construction of a leprosarium near Ban Mae Thuot.
January the 2nd, 1951, the first group of ragged and dusty men, women, and children afflicted with leprosy arrived at the new leprosarium in the trailer reserved for them. The first thing they received was a large piece of washing soap. Next, a warm woolen blanket and a grass mat were given to each one, and they were shown to their living quarters in the longhouse.
One of our American missionary nurses taught a grad A to be a lab technician. See, that's the purpose of our mission, to work ourselves out of jobs.
This one room called the foot wash room. That's one that I remember more than any, because that really kind of horrified me to think, to see them being treated with their feet. But because they'd bleed and they cut these ulcers away and all. And you would think that they'd really be in pain, but because they have leprosy, they don't have any pain. And they just sit there and talk to the nurses. They were taking care of their feet.
Gordon Smith wanted the leprosarium to be self-sufficient. The patients dammed a stream and cleared fields so they could grow their own vegetables. The facility expanded quickly, but not quickly enough to take in all those who needed help.
We give him a shirt and some soap to take back. "We want to enter now," she says. "We cannot walk back again all that way. We want to be healed." It breaks our hearts to have to send them away.
In 1954, the wind of change blew through the highlands yet again. The French, defeated at Dien Bien Phu, departed. The South Vietnamese government started moving ethnic Vietnamese into the highlands in an effort to assimilate the Montagnards.
What we were seeing at that time was the threat, the way the Montagnards perceived a threat to their cultural identity by the policies of the South Vietnamese government. And they really were feeling very threatened. And they cited endless examples of how this was happening. Things like the name of the towns were changed. They were all Montagnard names, or based on Montagnard names. And the Vietnamese made them all Vietnamese names. Endless things. And Gordon understood this and would exchange information with me. But as a missionary, you see, he had to play a very careful role, because he couldn't come out and openly criticize the government, because they would have kicked him out of the highlands. He had no legal status of any sort.
In 1956, Gordon Smith's independent ways caught up with him. Mission headquarters in the United States objected to his independent fundraising for the leprosarium. He resigned, but he didn't leave. He and Laura simply moved north to the coastal city of Da Nang and started a new Bible school of their own. Gordon Smith lived on the coast now, but still his heart was in the highlands, the Montagnard regions where few Westerners had ever set foot.
Setting up a mission in the Catu country. Now, the French had never really gotten into the country and pacified it, which is the term they used during the colonial period. And so he suggested that I go with him on one of the trips. So he organized a trip in August 1957 into the Catu country. And we started in, and it was incredibly hot. It was hot and steamy. As we were approaching the village, I noticed these things along the path. They were taboo signs, I was sure. Well, it turned out the village had a stockade, and the front door, the gate of the stockade was closed. And so we went into the village, and all the people had gotten into their houses and pulled the shutters. They were all peeking out at us. We went to the men's house, and the chief was sitting on a mat in the men's house with these young men, warriors, standing behind him, and their loincloths and very long hair and these 10-foot-long spears with these huge blades that they use for the blood sacrifices, the human blood sacrifices. What you do is dip the spears in the human blood after you kill the victim. Well, this this was very unsettling, to say the least. Gordon was very forthright about the whole thing and said, you know, I think we might have outdone ourselves. I said, I hope you're wrong. I said, but all the while, I said, remember, my friends, smile at the natives. Anyhow, The chief was very unfriendly. He said, I don't want any Frenchmen in the village. They thought all Westerners were French. And then we said, well, why not? And he said, the Viet Minh, now that's the old term for the Viet Cong, the communists. He said, the Viet Minh wouldn't like it. We said, are there any Viet Minh here? And he said, yes, they're in the forest. So anyhow, we left that village and we went to another village where they didn't have a stockade. And it turned out it had been two villages, but the sickness and lack of food had made life so difficult for the people that they decided to perform blood sacrifices. And Gordon explained to him that he had a boat coming up the river with some rice, a larger boat, and a nurse was on board the boat. We couldn't explain what a nurse was because they had no idea what a nurse was. In fact, they had never seen clothes like we were wearing. They'd never seen watches. They'd never seen cameras.
Near Da Nang, Gordon Smith founded a new leprosarium. American GIs were coming into Vietnam now, trying to make friends in the countryside. He welcomed them, and they pitched in to help construct the new building.
Gordon wanted the leprosarium to be not just an institution. He wanted it to be a place where the people were going to be very happy and, you know, develop a good outlook on life and not feel threatened. And then he wanted to make sure that the buildings were all placed well, so they were all going to be kind of pleasant and kind of very nice. It's like planning a resort in a way, you know, a very posh resort.
It was a lovely dream. But in 1962, the Vietnam War intruded violently into the missionary lives. Betty Mitchell's husband, Archie, was kidnapped from the leprosarium in Ban Mae Thuot.
You could hear their boots on the ground, and they were yelling, village people, get out, come on out, come on out. And we didn't have time to get out, really. They took their bayonets and cut the screen and jumped in and took my husband and tied him up. And then they, by the time I went out to there, I saw them taking him out. The children came in to me, and then they came in to get me, too, and took me out and started to tie me. They'd already tied him behind his back, with his arms behind his back. And then he said, and they started to lead him away. And then they said to him, he said to them, don't take her, let her stay with the children. And they started to lead him away. Even though it's many years since, and I've never had direct contact with Archie, I still have hope. Now, one thing that the tribal people would say to us, you know, you Americans are different than we are. This is our country. We live here. And if the war comes, we have to stay. But if it comes to you, you know, you can leave. You don't have to stay. Well, I felt that I really learned a lot after my husband was captured by the communists, because, and I didn't leave, because I knew God didn't want me to leave. I was to stay there to be with them and to help them. And this sort of opened the door. They sort of took me in then that I was part of them, because I had suffered like some of them had suffered, like many of them had suffered.
The war was getting worse and more violent. And more Montagnards were going as refugees, leaving their villages, abandoning the villages, flooding into other villages, into the forest. What it did really was disrupt their adaptations, their farming, their way of life. Everything was badly disrupted. And also, they were caught between the conflicting forces, which was really very deadly. The American South Vietnamese bombing, The use of herbicides, some of the groups were badly affected by that. The communists would attack buses and the roads. But then they started attacking villages at night, and a great many people died.
Montagnard villagers were evacuated to create free fire zones in which any person moving could be considered an enemy. In large relocation camps, the Montagnards were supposed to be housed and fed and protected.
What happened is that the resettlements were badly organized. The Vietnamese are the ones who were supposed to implement them. And the money was stolen, the houses didn't get built. They moved the people on soil that the Montagnards didn't know how to farm. They, by and large, were disastrous. I can't think of any of them that were successful. So the poor Montagnards would get fed up, and they'd pack up and move back to where they came from, in which case they were in the free fire zone. And so they were subject to bombing and shelling and what have you there. And these things happened all the time.
Before the war, every family has a small house with a stock of rice. And during the war, and then you have to go to a strategic hamlet, that stock of rice is destroyed. And then that is where the Montagnards begin to be hungry.
The missionaries tried to bring comfort to the Montagnard refugees. Gordon Smith's son, Stanley, opened a small church with his wife, Jenny, and started a school for refugee children. It was dangerous work. Several of the Vietnamese pastors with whom Stanley Smith worked were killed by the Viet Cong. Of course, by now, thousands of people were dying in the war. Gordon and Laura Smith turned their attention to the orphans who were left behind. They helped organize a network of orphan homes in the highlands. And at a spectacular site on China Beach near Da Nang, they built their largest orphanage. Nguyen Van Minh grew up in the Smith's orphanage on China Beach.
When I was 10 years old, I entered the orphanage near Da Nang, and it was a result of the kindness of the missionaries. I was a young boy, working almost like a slave. I had a mother, but my father was a French soldier who was no longer with us. I was an orphan and was taken care of very kindly at the China Beach orphanage. My memories at the orphanage were very fine, especially because I sensed love, especially from Mrs. Laura Smith. And to put it shortly, it was just that we were treated well. It was a very good experience.
The missionaries faced war bravely, but in 1968, when the Tet Offensive swept across the country, war simply overwhelmed them. The mission compound Gordon Smith had built at Ban Mai Thuot was attacked by the Viet Cong.
They threw a grenade in the bunker where I was with three other missionaries. And they were killed outright. They were close to the entrance. I was in a corner. So I had quite a few, what do you call them, shrapnel wounds. I thought I was dying, so I was forced to come out with a little tribes boy who had been injured too, and went across the road. And that's when I saw my husband. I saw him slumped over a clothesline. He was shot point blank, big gap. So I'm sure there was an instant of fear, but he had no pain.
Bob Zeamer and six other missionaries were killed in the attack. Marie Zeamer recovered from her wounds. She left Vietnam and never returned. The Smith's Leprosarium on a remote beach with no roads to it was preserved from the horrors of the war for a few more years. But on October 6, 1972, it was devastated by a sudden attack. Laura Smith wrote,
"It was a pitiful sight. Gordon and I wept over the cruel attack. On the grass, the wounded were lying on a few stretchers or bloody mattresses with blankets covering them. Most of them were poor patients already badly mutilated with their leprosy. But now, all of this suffering and misery was added."
One woman was killed, several patients wounded, almost every building destroyed. The patients had no other place to go. They could only rebuild and stay there. The U.S. Armed Forces sent donations. Marine General Lewis Walt helped raise money to ferry wounded orphans to the United States for surgery. And then one day, Laura Smith was able to write,
"It's January 28th, 1973. All of a sudden, the guns are silent. It's eerie and uncertain. The nightly booming of artillery has ceased. The roaring of jets has dwindled to almost nothing. And the small arms fire around Da Nang has given way to an uneasy peace. The ceasefire is here. By now, the U.S. armed forces have all gone from Vietnam. We saw the Japanese and French leave years ago. We surely miss the many American officers and men who, through the past 10 years, have been good friends to our work and staunch supporters. Now their great sprawling camps and bases are filled with tens of thousands of refugees, and the huge Da Nang Air Base seems almost deserted."
Gordon Smith had devoted 45 years of his life to the Highland people of Vietnam. He felt they needed him now more than ever. But he was 72. He had a failing heart. In 1974, Gordon and Laura Smith abandoned their mission home and returned to the United States. Their son Stanley remained to carry on. But the ceasefire soon unraveled. Viet Cong and North Vietnamese troops began their final assault. The battle turned to a rout, and Stanley Smith, his wife and four children, barely managed to escape from Da Nang.
What really happened was almost chaos. Vietnamese, by the hundreds, even thousands, were coming over the fence into the airport. And then there was kind of a stampede, and we actually had to run to the truck. And we made our way to this World Airways plane that had been chartered by the embassy to evacuate us. The engines were running, and it was a 727 Boeing. We were told to quickly get up on that plane, and as we went up the steps, the last person was up. Even before the last person was up, the pilot started taxiing out to the runway because he could see many other people coming and trying to get on the same flight.
Refugees poured out of Vietnam. Gordon and Laura Smith offered sponsorship in the United States to as many as they could. Gordon Smith sought to send relief supplies to Vietnam. He sought to return himself.
Even despite the fact that he knew that he was, he had cancer, up until the time he died in 77, he was still trying to negotiate to get back to Vietnam to be with his people. It was something that struck me as to show the great dedication that he had both for mission work but also for the great love he had for the people of Vietnam, both the Highland people and the Vietnamese.
Laura Smith lived on for 2 more years. She raised support for missionary activities until the day she died in 1979, 50 years from the time of her arrival in Croatia as a young wife and devoted missionary. And what became of it all the orphanage and the leprosarium, and the dreams of Gordon and Laura.
We've just landed at the Stella Port, which means city. Would you please remain sitting until the train comes to complete stop?
After 15 years of trying, Stanley and Jenny Smith returned to Vietnam in 1990.
Jenny and I were real happy to be able to go back to see how we might be able to be re-involved. We also wanted to portray to our Vietnamese co-workers and friends that we had not forgotten them.
And they were not forgotten. From all over the country, old colleagues and friends joined them for an emotional reunion.
Even though we're physically far apart, we are together in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for taking care of us through difficult times.
Life had been hard. There were stories to tell of death and imprisonment. Nguyen Van Minh, who grew up in the China Beach Orphanage, has become an evangelist himself.
I was imprisoned in 1975. When the revolution became successful, they felt that anyone like me could not be a part of a new society. The government felt that I had been involved with the Phun Rô movement, which is a movement among Sam Mountain people. But this was untrue. I had never been an agent for the American government. I have never been involved with this movement for separation from the central government. But I was falsely accused, and I had to go to jail for 12 years.
The churches founded by Gordon Smith are closely watched by the Hanoi government, but they are open and self-sufficient, and their congregations are growing. The pastors think they have reason to hope for an end to the jailing and harassment they have suffered.
Indigenous church is what we want. That's what our mission has always stood for. And I have real hopes for the church to continue to grow, both here and in Vietnam too, in spite of the problems. Under persecution, a lot of times the church is stronger, you know that.
And the leprosarium near Da Nang, into which Gordon Smith poured so much of his life and energy, it is still there. Stanley Smith was not allowed to visit it, but he was able to see it from a distance.
It looked like the buildings, for the most part, were intact. But even more importantly, we had heard that even though it was under the jurisdiction of the communist government, that they were doing a fair job with the leprosy ministry, and the leprosy patients themselves knew that we were in Da Nang and were expecting us to visit, and of course were quite disappointed when we did not go because of the lack of permission.
The war was deadly for the Montagnards. They lost their lives by the tens of thousands. Most of their villages were destroyed. Their culture was shattered. But here and there in jungle clearings, groups of them still come together regularly and reverently for Christian services. The seed Gordon Smith planted in these remote places remains stubbornly alive and growing. East and West collided violently in Vietnam with many casualties. But those who remember Gordon and Laura Smith remember that East and West did not always collide. Once, they touched.
Yeah.